So welcome. My name is Eliza Montgomery. I am an architect. I work for a company in just downtown called Enya Architects. And I'm here today because we have been working for the past about 5 or 6 years on a project with the UNHCR, sort of working with them to develop new tools and a new framework for how they can, their plans can plan refugee communities in sort of the place we are in today, which is that, you know, their long-term situation is not short-term situation. So in the breakout session today, first I'll tell you a little bit about some of the work that we've been doing, but then after that, we're gonna do a little exercise all together. And so you'll see some little cards on your table. I'll pass a few more out here since it looks like there's you don't need to worry about reading them all right now, but I'll tell you what to do in a little bit. So we first began working on this project in 2012 through our build projects at Stanford University. We've done a number of buildings there. We met a professor who was already working on a few projects with the UNHCR on really rethinking how they can be strategized in a way that can benefit local communities as well and just as much as the refugees. So through that professor at Stanford, we were invited to come and join some of the workshops they were doing and bring a missing component, which was the spatial component. The design and spatial component. So ever since then, we've been working with Stanford and the UNHCR, but we've also, more recently, we've been working with a few other organizations. We've been teaching at the New School and at Pratt, and working with city organizations like the Legacy Cities Partnership in the US and the City of Amsterdam. We've been doing a lot of work with the situation in Europe. So, as you know, I'm sure you all, this is preaching to the choir here because you all have a lot of expertise and, you know, we've heard a lot of great stuff this morning, but refugee camps have traditionally been designed for short time frames. Of course, the hope is that the conflicts will be resolved and either the refugees will be able to go back to their own country or they'll be able to be resettled in a third country. But in reality, the average length of protracted refugee situation is 26 years. So refugee camps have indefinite time frames, and therefore planning strategies have to be rethought to address this. We can't just design for the emergency situation, we have to design for transition and change throughout different phases, and even integration or an exit phase in the long term. We simply don't know how long they will be there, and so we have to plan for any kind of outcome. And then in order to plan for these indefinite front time frames, it's imperative that refugees have agency. Whether it's a short term or a long term, no one benefits from a relationship of dependency. This left photo, and I think someone brought it up this morning as well, is a camp in Turkey called Kilis. Most camps in Turkey are built by the Turkish government independently from the UNHCR. And then the camp on the right is Zatri in Jordan, which I'm sure you all are very familiar with. At face value, the camp in Turkey might be thought of as a preferable place to be. It has containers which are more durable than the tents. It's clean. They hire Turkish workers to clean up the camp. It's safe. There are metal detectors to go in, and refugees have a scan card to enter. There's power lines, street lines, there's even playgrounds here. But when reporters have actually gone and interviewed refugees there, they found a much higher level of frustration there than in the other places like Zatri or even in other more urban situations. Maybe because too much is provided for them in this camp in Turkey, the refugees don't have a reason or a drive to partake in activities to make this place more of a home for themselves. Zatri, on the other hand, is the sort of the opposite extreme in terms of camps. Refugees have undertaken an enormous amount of self-driven modifications to the camp to address their needs. So the road you see down the center is nicknamed the Champs-Élysées because it's a sort of vibrant market filling the length of the camp, and it grew really 100% out of the refugees' initiatives. Obviously, the disaster isn't a perfect situation by any means, but there's a lot more life and a lot more opportunity there than maybe the camp in Turkey. So when given agency, refugees have the opportunity to reclaim their lives and make the place a home. Whether they'll be there for a short term or a long term, this is essential for a camp to be a dignified place to live. They need entrepreneurial opportunities. So this is a barbershop that was in Zaatari camp. And their homes need to be appropriate for their cultures and their lifestyles. So this house has started with just a typical container, but then it was augmented to include a porch and a fountain and a garden on the side, and then even a private water tank in the back. So the question for us as designers is, how do we design with enough flexibility to allow for these things to happen, but with enough structure to maintain safety and health, and how do we allow for this to be a place where refugees feel a sense of ownership? So if we take a step back and sort of rethink what a refugee camp is, most photos that are published to the general public highlight, you know, the grid-like rows and rows of shelters or even tents. But when you really look inside, you find that there are a lot of similarities to cities and organic communities. At the end of the day, they have economies, they have markets, there's education and health centers, and public gathering spaces. They have all the components of the cities, but they weren't initially designed or planned like cities. And secondly, and maybe even more importantly, existing communities around the refugees have the opportunity to become partners. Traditionally, they've been thought of as hosts, and this implies that the refugees may be a burden to them. But as partners, both sides can benefit equally from the situation. When you look at it this way, partner communities should actually be competing for refugees. So when we first began this project, we were working with the UNHCR and with Stanford, and we asked ourselves, what is the potential for shared resources between the existing communities and the incoming refugee communities? Can we take sort of an inventory of both populations, noting what each community has an abundance of and sort of what their strengths are and what resources they're lacking? And then can we design the incoming settlement to provide for shared resources that sort of fill in the gaps where both populations are lacking? Over time, more and more shared resources can be designed to really fill these gaps, and at the optimal situation is that by the end, they're all sharing the resources and both places are better than they were, but both populations have a better situation than when they started with. So as architects and planners, how do we help make this happen? Although it's important to design shelters and build structures, no one building design is ever going to be like the best solution for every different environment and culture. So instead, we've been working to create a framework for critical thinking that can apply to many different types of planning. The framework of tools is applied across a matrix of both multiple time frames, so going from the contingency before a crisis even emerges, even happens, to the emergency phase, transition, on all the way to either an integration or an exit phase. And on the other side of the matrix is different scales. Traditionally, it may have been more really only thought of in the micro scale, but it's really important to think of the impact of these population movements on the mesoscale and the macro scale as well. I don't have time to go over all the tools in depth right now, so we have time for a little exercise. but I'll give you just a quick overview of some of the main goals in each category. As we have really been designing the tools so that they can be used not only by humanitarian actors and planners, but by partners and government agencies, and almost most importantly, by the refugees themselves, so that they are part of the design process. And it's crucial to involve all different fields, economists, cultural anthropologists, policy experts, planning, environmental experts. So on the macro scale, one of the tools is a site selection tool, and it's a software or an app that's designed to be used during the contingency phase or emergency phase of a decision making as a decision making and negotiating tool when locations for refugees are first being considered. So in the past, a lot of situations, the refugee camps are basically placed in suboptimal locations because it's the only place that the government is willing to allow for this. But if we think about what is needed in that existing region, there's a lot of benefits that can happen by bringing that population in. So this tool pulls together environmental data and social and economic data, and then you can weight the different criteria based on how important they are for each different situation. So it would be weighted differently for every place around the world or every different situation. And then it pulls those weighted data point collections together to create sort of a heat map to show where maybe are better places for this refugee population to come in, or worse places. It can be used to sort of look at it from the perspective of both the host, the partner community, as well as the refugees. So for example, and you can move the sliders to kind of calibrate it from both those perspectives. So for example, if the host government or maybe a existing town there were to point out that they didn't have enough schools for their existing population there, they could use this tool to show that if we use humanitarian aid money to build new schools that can serve both the refugee population and the local population, then ultimately that becomes a benefit for both sides. And then with the tool, you could zoom in and sort of understand why each point is either more on the green side or more on the red side. So on the meso scale, the tools focus on sort of highlighting the benefits of alternative planning typologies. Most refugee camps traditionally have been designed as separated settlements with clear boundaries, sort of as the first diagram. But in all different situations, this really may not be the most appropriate for existing typologies or existing conditions that are there. If it's more of an agrarian lifestyle, it may be more appropriate to have much, much smaller sort of satellite settlements that are dispersed and intertwined within the local community, and then have these nodes of resources that can connect together and ultimately help both populations. Or an urban lamination, if an urban center is dense, but on the outskirts there's sort of a lack of resources for the existing population, then that can be a key place where new resources can be put and shared between the two communities. Or an urban integration typology could be where there's an existing city that has had a declining population, so a lot of post-industrial cities in the U.S. They've had a declining population over the last 20, 40 years, and there may be a lot of vacant property or abandoned resources that could be reutilized, and a new population coming in help jumpstart that economy. So for example, in Gary, Indiana, the population has dramatically declined since its peak in the mid-60s, and there's a lot of vacant property. So how could clusters of refugees come in to help revive the vacant properties? Similarly with the commercial corridors, how could a new population come in and help revive and activate these commercial corridors? And public buildings, resources come in and help improve in my school that can now serve both the local community as well as the refugees coming in. So then on the micro scale, this really consists of a catalog of spatial and adjacency vignettes that are intended to accompany the very quantitative parameters that are already given by UNHCR and the other humanitarian standards. Each vignette isolates a specific planning component to point out the benefits and pitfalls of different spatial options. So working with the, this also in the scale, we're really looking at the process. What is the optimal process to design these communities? In the past, there's been a lot of focus on the plots and the actual shelters, and that results in these very sort of grid-like layouts. But instead of designing the shelter layouts and the plot, could we instead focus on the public program elements? And instead of separating them from the residential areas, can we begin to mix them and allow them to merge so that different communities have equal access to different public amenities? And by nature, then different neighborhoods would have different feels, like what happens in our cities that we all live in. Could sort of some very very conceptual zoning guidelines help design this rather than strict shelter layout in order to allow the refugees to really then come in and utilize that space the way that works best for them, because at the end of the day, they know that better than we as humanitarian planners do. So working with the UNHCR, we've engaged in a few different case studies in Rwanda, in Ethiopia. We've studied and worked in the camps in Jordan, and most recently we've worked in some situations in Nepal on camps that have been there since 1992. So for the Rwanda study, this was one of the first studies we did back in probably 2013. We held a workshop in our office with ourselves as architects, as well as experts from other different fields, UNHCR site planners, and managers. We had policy experts from Stanford, we had landscape and environmental designers. In this specific workshop, one thing, we were missing a few crucial things, which were economists and anthropologists, but we're working to bring them in into future workshops. And we implemented and evaluated the tools in the context of this one camp. We actually felt that a short 3-day charrette was unfortunately kind of appropriate, because this is those are the time frames that site planners are faced with you know, resettling 20,000 people at a time. So we had very little site information at the time, so we extracted what we could from easily accessible resources, open source resources, and we created a plan that made the best use of the steep topography and the existing roads that we knew would be the main connections to the nearby villages, in order to sort of reinforce that connection with the nearby villages. We visited the site and studied more specifically the land itself. Actually, by the time we got there, they already started terracing the land and were already experiencing a lot of erosion because they didn't have the right site evaluation or the right topographic models that they were working with at the time. And then we made sort of, after the site visit, we made a field calibrated and refined map based on these findings that included shared resources that would benefit the existing population also. So we've also been evolving the toolkit through a number of teaching engagements with UNHCR and Stanford, with Pratt, and most recently with the New School. In these teaching resources, we've been using hypothetical scenarios for students to really think about these issues in a whole different way. And we've actually been basing most of the hypothetical scenarios in US cities, even though the high numbers that we're seeing in the Middle East and in Europe aren't happening here in the US, we think it's a really valuable way to look at the situation still. And we've given, each person a role to play throughout the whole workshop, either a humanitarian or a refugee or a someone from the partner community. And so then each person evaluated the situation from their specific role. What does each other expect or need from each other? And how would you evaluate the absorption capacity of the area at hand? What are the most important components to provide as shared resources? And where would the most strategic places for these resources be? So the students have come up with some really interesting and creative ideas in the past. We've used a few different hypothetical scenarios, some in all different typologies of urban elimination or integration or satellite settlements. But so today we're going to do one of these hypothetical scenarios. It's going to be very, very brief because we don't have much time at all. But we wanted to sort of take you guys through some of the different ways of approaching some of the questions as if this were a real site. So this is Newburgh, New York, upstate. Some of you probably are familiar with it. It is also another place that has had a declining population and has really been struggling as a post-industrial U.S. city. It's more racially diverse now than it used to be. It has a growing Latin immigrant, mainly Mexican descent population, and it also has a sizable African American contingent. It's been facing issues regarding illegal immigration lately, like a lot of other cities in the U.S., and has faced issues of overcrowding apartment buildings, but then there's also a lot of vacant buildings in the city. This is a map of all of the different, or a few different vacant properties, both residential as well as public buildings. This is the waterfront, which used to be a very industrial area, but is quickly changing. These are just a couple of images from the downtown, which as you can see, doesn't really have a lot of the energy that it used to. Just a couple of statistics on age and education. We won't focus on this too much because we have such a short time. I don't want anyone to feel, to sort of get in the weeds of specific statistics. But at your tables, everybody, there are cards at your table. So everybody just pick a card for yourself, and that is your, that's going to be your role for the next 30 minutes. You'll be the person on this card. Just a disclaimer, people are, some of them are half accurate, but we also kind of made up the stories a little bit. So don't hold us to any of these stories directly. But take a moment to read your stories. Feel free to talk with your table mates about their stories. And while you do that, I'm going to pass out the next little exercise. should be one for each person, but actually you're welcome to share if you want, or work in teams or whatever. But this is a, we call it a propeller diagram, and what we want you to do is take the stories from your players and imagine you're that person and you're coming to, I guess I forgot to give you the scenario. So in this hypothetical scenario, there are 5,000 refugees coming into Newburgh, New York. I know this is a really high number for what we're typically used to in the US, but these kind of numbers do exist in other places in the world. So, so we wanted to kind of start extreme. So there are 5,000 refugees. Some of them are the stories that you guys have on your table, which are the green border cards. There are also some stories of some of the people from the partner community in Newburgh. Some of them are government officials. Some of them are just residents who live there. And then the green is humanitarian actors. I'm sorry. The light blue are the refugees. So think about your character. And on these propeller diagrams, if you are a refugee, think about some of the most crucial things that you expect or really need from the other players. So what do you need from the partners in order to make this a successful scenario for you? What do you need from the humanitarian actors? And then, you know, that's oftentimes in the past, we've all been thinking about what the refugees need in this situation, but in order to make this a beneficial situation for everyone, we really equally want to think about what the partners need. So if you got one of the partner cards, really think about how this new incoming population can help make Newburgh a better place or help your specific situation. So think about what you need or expect from the refugees and what you need or expect from the humanitarian actors. And then same thing with the humanitarian actors. In order to make this really successful, what do you expect from the refugees and what components do you expect from the partners? Because we have so little time today, don't worry about trying to solve every single problem that comes into your mind, but you know, maybe it's something specific about education or about the healthcare that you need or don't have. Or maybe it's about you are a local or you're a refugee and you really want to start a business because you were, a baker back in your home country. So just think about very specific things and try and sort of fill out this diagram. Yeah.
What's the current population of Newburgh?
The current population, sorry, that's a good point that I did not give you. It is almost 30,000 people.
30,000?
Yes. So take about 10 minutes. Again, I'm sorry we have very little time for this, but take about 10 minutes. Feel free to talk with the others at your table, and sort of you can ask them what their player ask them a little bit about their player, and maybe that will give you an idea about sort of what you need from each other.
Yeah, actually, I'm not sure. 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 I'm not sure So mine's on July.
Okay.
It's a single mom.
Are we writing it here or?
Watch.
Okay. Which one?
We see it. We're just about to find out.
I think we're.
She said the. And I heard her.
Well.
Okay.
So that's.
And she lost her captain. She went.
It's like they not think that here would be punished. She always. So she doesn't.
Right. So for in. In this zone, we would write what the partners expect from the humanitarian actors. And we are also asked what the partners expect from the partners. What do these two sort of represent humanitarians need from each other or explain to each other? Just a little. Who are willing to do this. We have not determined. The only thing I can think of is how the organization are most. As also just curious.
Moving in terms of.
PJ.
Yeah.
Rather than taking.
Rather than. I suppose I'm just curious. They kind of read all this. But.
Well, it seems like it has needs more space, right? Or I guess, like if he has more people to program the people.
Okay.
Monday, I'm not thinking of your thing.
And
I guess he's. I guess not clear why it's trouble.
Yeah.
Not clear why.
What I was. I think it's probably enough.
It's a bit of a threat by the.
Everyone's.
Works.
Yeah.
There's a way that that's. Support.
I have one. I have one that.
Yeah, so I was in this.
So this partner.
Unless.
Doctor.
If I did that.
So as a partner, he has quite a few things that he probably wants to get her. He's a former.
But is there an opportunity for a job? She was a driver before, like all their services were very common.
Yeah, I mean, there should be for expectation for the answer.
Really important.
First.
Especially.
Yeah, she does.
In terms of what he. Right now. The rapid sea works. So it's talking about what.
Did maybe speak up silently?
Yeah.
See, it's very.
it's like kind of people who are talking to each other. So
it's a more educated.
Oh, grow or.
What does he mean?
Well, there's also
so should we go into the McMillian and walking it?
Well, my farm.
Houses, or is it just like Can't, yeah, like a campus.
Yeah, or a school space or
something. So. And they're just kind of managing the process. Like the process, a pretty good track of what's vacant, when, what you can insert, where you're trying to revive. Yeah, and it doesn't really say.
There will be a regional conference.
This is just as abandoned property, it could be ready.
There is. Well, this is your.
Share any of
have a 10-year anniversary festival to be tasted in Dubai. It's going to be lots of good food in Dubai with our Syrian population. Okay. And also, is it Mexican based population? Mm-hmm. So we're just focusing on the positives. Good food.
Yeah, that's good food. Celebration.
Yes.
Thanks. Gracias.